I'm Nick Verebelyi. I run an independent brand design consultancy, working with designers and with brand owners to ensure that their brands are engaging to consumers and also to help, in some instances, to innovate and to redefine those brands. I'm a very firm advocate of the dual role of packaging. There's clearly the functional aspects, which is the primary concern of the packaging manufacturing industry. The practical issues of getting the product from the point of manufacture to the point of consumption. But I also recognise and advocate the importance of the secondary, which is all about communication. There's factual communication, which is kind of the information on the pack, and there's a lot of concern and debate about ingredients and nutritional information and so forth, and recycling and all the rest. There's a level of communication which is much more about subliminal emotional communication, which I think is equally important. In fact, in some cases more important, because consumers can't filter that kind of message out. They are influenced by the way in which a pack has been composed, put together, the way its structure has been defined, in ways that they can't articulate, but it helps them, genuinely helps them to navigate the retail experience and to choose the right product for them. I think the skill of the designer is in the way in which they balance the fundamental requirements, the practical requirements, and the communication issues. The real trick is to use some of the practical and the functional and to deliver those in a way which is fundamentally unique to the brand promise. So that the way in which, for example, a shampoo bottle opens and closes is done in such a way that it fully supports and is actually part and parcel of the unique promise that that brand is making to the consumer. I think in a world of constant change, the designer has a vital part to play in providing engaging solutions to the consumer. Nothing is static. The consumer will probably never admit that they are looking for change or for evolution, but in fact, as human beings, we get bored. We are constantly, like children, we are attracted by the new. And that's both the opportunity, but it's both the absolute requirement for brands to absolutely ensure that they remain relevant and that they're continuing to stimulate and engage the consumer. As designers, that's where we can help. On the economy, the packaging design community, as in fact the whole design community, in certainly in 2009, had a very, very tough year, with income levels falling by about 13% and staffing around about 30%, which hit the industry in a really dramatic way, as can be expected. However, for 2010, the prognosis is very good, and obviously until all the stats are in, it's difficult to say, but nobody really, any of the consultancies were reporting expected drop in income levels over the course of the year. And in fact, many were predicting growth. About 30% were expecting a 20% growth over the course of 2010, which clearly is good news for the industry. And I think it reflects probably the most buoyant aspect of the design industry, which is that part that deals in FMCG branding and marketing. It's a truism, I know, but when times are tough, consumers are going to continue to clean their homes, certainly need to eat. And if anything, there's a tendency, as we know, to defer expenditure into the kind of smaller ticket items that you can buy in a supermarket. So certainly the retail environment has remained quite buoyant. I think in terms of real step change innovation, during the course of the last couple of years, certainly the brakes were put on. Just as investment was cut back, all businesses had to play cautious, credit being incredibly difficult to secure. And that has meant that many of the more substantial developments and innovation programs were put on hold. So in terms of physical packaging, that certainly took a hit. And I think that's where the floodgates have certainly opened during the course of this year, because that situation can't continue. There is an inexorable need to evolve, to change, to respond to changing consumers' demands, to competitive activity and so forth. And brands can only kind of redefine themselves so many times graphically, and to say, introduce a new colour or a new set of visual imagery, ultimately, it's the proposition itself that needs to evolve. There is a class, if you like, of products that are in the kind of added value luxury end of the spectrum, where the packaging is clearly much more part and parcel of the product experience, of that which is the reason the consumer is buying that product. So it's very much a mix of, there might be a liquid that's used to cleanse our bodies or to clean the home or whatever, that is delivered more conveniently, more practically, does its job better, that is capable of doing its job at all because of the delivery system, if you like, that which is more than the transport mechanism. And so it should be, as consumers, as I think I've mentioned before, change is an inexorable fact. Markets evolve, consumer wants and needs evolve, and we can't turn the clock back, or certainly very, very difficult to turn the clock back. I think it's, in terms of the way in which design responds to these realities, I would actually say that there's two ways of looking at or being very clear in one's mind about the fundamental role of the pack. Clearly there are products where the pack is very little to add in terms of the consumer experience, added value, luxury and so forth. And in those instances, it's absolutely essential that packaging, first of all, can we eliminate it? Can we avoid having it at all? There are clearly many much reported examples of products that fundamentally don't need protection because they are robust enough to protect themselves. I mean, I'm appalled to see whole chickens, for example, packed in vast amounts of rigid plastic, you know, vacuum-formed shells, when traditionally the cellophane wrap, the film wrap, was perfect for the job. The product is robust enough to go through the supply chain. You just need to protect it from a degree of contamination, and the consumer obviously demands hygiene and cleanliness. So, you know, I think packaging needs to be proportionate, absolutely, to the requirements of the product. The challenge, if you like, of different cultural influences and different customs becomes quite a fundamental part of the way in which projects are tackled. There are quite obvious market differences in the sort of products that consumers buy, for example. Germans do consume an awful lot of dried food mixes, sauces, soups and so forth. The sheer range and variety of those sorts of products is triple, quadruple what we would see here on the UK shelves. And there's a far greater acceptance of that type of product. The way in which, for example, again, the French and the Germans will present their foodstuffs is very much more traditional, very much more conservative. We here in the UK have grown accustomed to a far less literal, if you like, and a more abstract and freer way in which some of the benefits of these sort of products are communicated. So, as designers, we've obviously got to understand the nuances of different marketplaces. And going back to the earlier point, of a lot of the products that we buy are quite centralised, owned by fewer and fewer global multinationals. To reap the efficiencies and the benefits of that concentration, of course, there is a continuing drive to try to harmonise brands and products across different markets and different regions. And that often presents a challenge, and certainly in terms of the customs of different markets, the sizing, the brand history, for example, of exactly the same product in one country to another. And hence we find ourselves as designers very often going through a phase of migrating a brand from what it is in one market to what ultimately it might eventually end up globally. And you know, this continues to engage us and to certainly takes quite a considerable part of the resource of fulfilling a design exercise. Legislatively and in terms of the regulatory framework, in many cases these are becoming increasingly harmonised in any case. And I think we very much need to work in partnership with our clients who are clearly well versed in what those local scenarios are, and so that we can design accordingly. I think some of the kind of global trends that we've seen will continue, the main ones being the drive for choice, which drives change. We will always want to be able to choose what's right for us, and there will always be new propositions. As long as there is competition and there is a capitalist model in operation, clever people will be devising new offers and trying to understand the unmet needs that as consumers we have and try to deliver against those. I think convenience, again, is a trend that will continue. Added value as well. I think what overrides all of those things is the inexorable demand for value. So convenience and added value is going to be demanded, but it's going to be demanded and will continue to be demanded at a very cost-effective, in a cost-effective way. I think the challenge that presents to designers is that really we need to get much closer to the supply chain, much closer to the, if you like, the production side of the clients that we work with. Traditionally, designers have, I think, and this is very often to do with the relationship that exists between a client and designer, have been kind of held at arm's length in terms of the logistics and the supply chain aspects of companies. And unless one has a full and comprehensive understanding of the issues and the parameters that are involved, the claim can, will always be leveled at designers that, creating an ivory tower, have no real comprehension of practicality and so forth. What creatives are very good at is reconciling the often contradictory and what seemingly is unreconcilable. So in other words, the vision, if you like, the promise of how engaging something could be, how beautiful something could be, how superbly functional something could be, relative to some of the practicalities of actually getting those things manufactured, produced, and out into the consumer's hands at an acceptable and affordable cost. So I think to achieve that, really, the kind of barriers that possibly exist today need to break down. New models of working together need to be established. Clearly, there are moves to consolidate the relationship between brand owners and designers through rosters and so forth. I think they need to now evolve into a greater state of openness so that, on the one hand, for example, agencies and design teams can resource themselves in preparation for the type of challenges that will be put to them. There needs to be an investment on both sides in terms of bringing the designer literally in-house to see the way in which products and materials are procured, work through the supply chain and got out the other end into the retail environment. Trade marketing needs to be understood more coherently. So I think this kind of more collaborative approach is where the future lies in terms of the way in which the design community will work. And another aspect, I think, of this is probably most to do with post-recession, is the availability of good creative resource. The reaction has been of necessity to cut back and to secure economies within agencies. That has meant now that it's actually quite difficult to find the right people for the right job in a cost-effective way. It's no longer necessarily the obvious thing to highly resource and highly recruit an agency with lots of skills that may or may not be required at any particular time. So there's got to be a much more flexible model, and I think collaboration is the way forward in terms of the way, as designers, we work together. But it remains an exciting future, and I think, as I said, the role of packaging will continue to be absolutely vital in that.